You ever waken up in the middle of the night and think, in another 20 or 30 years, I'm going to be 50 or 60. What shall I be doing? You don't.
You never think of that. I mean...
Doesn't haunt you.
Well, sorry, what did someone say something with a very deep voice like Lord Tennyson?
It doesn't haunt you, that in the moment.
I don't think I'll live that long.
You don't?
No.
Marc Bolan had his first hit single at the age of 23. It was not a flash in the pan, it was not overnight success. The road to the top had been long, hard and tiring. His untimely death on the morning of September the 16th, 1977 in the car crash stunned his fans and the music world alike. As the opening clips have chillingly illustrated, Marc always carried with him the premonition of an early death. His obsession with cars, both in his private life and through his songs, ironically became a focus of his death 2 weeks prior to his 30th birthday.
And I noticed that several of your songs have make references to cars. The one you just did, Jeepster, earlier on, the verse, there's a verse about, I wrote it down. Just like a car, you're pleasing to behold, I'll call you Jaguar if I may be so bold.
I meant for the animal, actually.
I see. But I noticed in none of your lyrics, you say, I'll buy you a car and then I'll throw it away later. But is car very important? Are cars important?
American, Cadillac. I mean, I've got that from an amazing car which someone gave to me at one point. An old Cadillac, which was a work of art. It was a masterpiece.
As a car?
I don't drive. But, I mean, an amazing car, yeah.
Born Marc Feld on the 30th of September 1947 in London, he grew up absorbing the musical influences of the 50s in the sounds of Presley, Cochran and Haley. After a brief adventure in modelling clothes, his musical career started as a solo artist with little real success before joining his first serious band, John's Children. The frustration of not being in total control led to his departure from this band. The sudden move left him without equipment, and so, armed with only an acoustic guitar, he teamed up with percussionist Steve Peregrine Took and named the duo Tyrannosaurus Rex. Over the next 2.5 years, the foundation of Bolan's rise to superstardom was built. In that period, Bolan flirted with the singles chart and made even further headway with the 3 albums that spanned the partnership with Took. Following musical and personal differences, Took left, and in the autumn of 1969, Mickey Finn arrived on the scene, and that gave Marc a much clearer vision of the future. Within a year, with the name now shortened to the much more manageable T-Rex, Bolan was about to unleash his first hit single, Ride a White Swan. June Feld, Marc's widow, reflects.
We were living in Marble Arch then, in one of those high-rise security prisons, and had a spare bedroom which we'd egg-boxed and done all that stuff to. And we were sitting in the sitting room and he suddenly got this... He used to get this weird look in his eye, this sort of third-dimensional sort of space look. And he suddenly jumped up and he whisked off. He said, I've got to go. And off he went. And there was all this clinking and plonking and... And I had the television on and I was reading and doing a crossword and all things at the same time. And they said, come and listen to this. And I whizzed out, went into the room, and it was, and there it was, Ride a White Swan. And it was on, he said, and then the first thing he always asked, I don't know if he asked anybody else this, is, does it sound like anything else? Does it sound like anything you've ever heard before? And then I'd listen and I'd say, well, a bit like whatever. Bit of Howling Wolf in there, or a bit of Bob Dylan, or... No, I haven't! And then you go away. You say, well, go out. you'd go out and you'd hear both, used to do it on t.rex, had two linked t.rex, and you'd go out and you'd hear the tapes whizzing back, and then he'd drop it down the track because he'd go on to the next track, and then you'd hear, and it suddenly would alter subtly and change, and then you'd get called back, and you'd summoned, then you'd go sit on the floor, no chairs, on the floor, hit the knob, and then he'd play, and then you'd listen, and he'd say, what do you think? And I said, it's great, wonderful. I'm sure it'll be a hit. Doesn't sound like anybody else? No, it doesn't sound like anybody else. And that was it. And it was done. And then he'd used to ring Tony Visconti. Whatever time, day or night, didn't matter. Could be 4 a.m. when he'd done that. And then it was, Tone, I've just written the next single. And then, can I come over? And often we'd go over at 4 a.m. with his t.rex tape. And Tony would be up. He'd play it. And he'd offer suggestions which Mark took no notice of. Then Mark would go away. And suddenly when they got to the studio, some of Tony's suggestions were in there, but they weren't Tony's, they were Mark's. All Mark.
By the end of 1970, whilst Ride Away Swan rode high in the singles chart, T-Rex expanded the sound by recruiting bass guitarist Steve Curry. When 1971 finally dawned, Bolan knew that he needed a drummer. It was actually Tony Visconti who found the answer.
When Tony asked me, I just said, well, yeah, I'll give it a go. No problems. I was aware of their newfound success as far as Ride Away Swan. But I must admit, I went out and bought some of the old albums because I'd never heard anything before that Mark had done previously. So I was just trying to familiarise myself with what he was doing. And I went from there. She's my woman of gold.
The one I liked most was Hot Love. That had just got a lovely lilt to it. And it was just... In fact, when we were on stage and it used to break strings, I always used to play that. Go into that, and I even used to sing it, you know, messing about. I don't know, I just liked it. It was perfect, really. She ain't no witch, and I love.